So our partial pressure is this, and this is the Rawls law. So the Rawls law says that for a solution of volatile liquids, the partial vapor pressure of each component of the solution, the partial vapor pressure is directly proportional to its mole fraction present in solution. So you understand, mark the difference and mark it very well. This has to hold always. Why? Because this is Dalton's law of partial pressure. So what is the contribution of Rawls? Rawls says, fine, this is gaseous, mind it. This is the mole fraction in the gaseous phase. I want you to understand these. Do not confuse. I have students asking me if P1 is equal to X1 P total and P1 is equal to X1 P1 naught. Aren't you saying that P total is P1 naught and P total is also P2 naught? Does it not mean that P1 naught is equal to P2 naught? And that is the biggest ditch that we fall in. As I told you, you will not be able to calculate the mole fraction in the vapor phase, but you will definitely be able to find out the mole fraction in the solution state. Correct? You understand this contribution of the guy. He says this is in solution. This is also in solution. Now what happens, you understand? Here or here? Here it was. Here there was only one component present in the solution state. In the solution state. So what will be my pressure? P1 naught. Yes, it is P1 naught. And this must have given him the initiative to form this equation. And this equation is found to be correct. Now what happens? I know P1 naught. It is measurable. I know X1 naught. Why? Because I can see the mole fraction of the two liquids that I've mixed. So in effect, I will be able to know this partial pressure that it is going to contribute in the vapor phase. Mind it. By knowing the vapor pressure of the pure substance, by knowing its mole fraction in the solution, I am able to tell you its contribution in the total pressure. So there is an X1 here, there is an X1 here. Don't get confused. This X1 is in solution. This X1 is in gaseous. So don't intermingle these two equations. Correct? Maybe you should have. Here I should have done that. But since this is something that we had done from yesterday, that's why I did not change it. But there is a tremendous difference between the two. Fine? So what is the Rawls law? Rawls law says that for a solution of volatile liquids, the partial vapor pressure. So let us write that. For a solution of volatile liquids, the vapor pressure, the partial vapor pressure of each component of the solution, the partial vapor pressure of each component of the solution is directly proportional to its mole fraction in the solution state. is directly proportional to its mole fraction present in the solution. Is directly proportional to its mole fraction in solution. So now you understand the ease of it. I am able to know that in the total pressure, what will be the contribution from one of the liquids and what will be the contribution from the other liquid. Do we get that? That I'll be able to understand. And you understand, since when I introduced them into the chamber, they were in the liquid phase. So I don't know how much of it got evaporated. From the total you will be able to know, but then if they are absolutely purely miscible, then you won't be able to know how much of which has evaporated. You understand that? In gases, it is quite easy. Why? Because you are introducing a gas in a gaseous phase. You understand? So there, this is easy. I'll be able to know because I know how much mole of the gas I have inputted, right? I take an oxygen cylinder, maybe a nitrogen cylinder, and say it was weighing, say, 10 kg, and I passed on some 500 grams. So immediately I know how many number of moles have gone in. Then I take another cylinder, and maybe I push in some half kg of, say, helium. Then say followed by that half kg of oxygen, then followed by that say half kg of chlorine. Then I exactly know how many moles of each has been pushed in. Okay, so there the components are in vapor phase, in gaseous phase, and I am inputting them in vapor phase. So that was pretty simple. This equation was more helpful. Here the trouble was you won't be able to, you introduced it in form of a liquid and it got evaporated, it became gas, and you have no way of knowing how much of it became gas. So you should understand the importance of this, what this fellow is saying. We get that? Now if you get that, then the total pressure, so do I erase this? Fine. So the total pressure that is built here, okay, so the total pressure that you feel inside the chamber, inside that closed chamber, here we had written it for that, x1, x2 is for the gaseous phase, that was for the last equation. Here you will write that x1, x2 are the mole fractions in, here x1, x2 are mole fractions in the solution state, right? Is it? R-A-O-U, fine, so it is R-A-O-U-L-T-S. Ford's law. Okay. Here, your X1, X2 is, X1 and X2 in Rolle's law is mole fraction of liquids in the solution, okay, fine. So I say that P1 is directly proportional to X1. So when it goes away, I get P1 is equal to X1 P1 naught. So the vapor pressure comes in as the constant of proportionality. okay? And similarly, P2 is directly proportional to X2. So P2 is equal to X2 P2 naught.
Now, obviously, the
total pressure, P total, is P1 plus P2. So that is obviously X1 P1 naught plus X2 P2 naught. And you obviously understand P1 naught is the vapor pressure of 1 in pure state when nothing else was present. Similarly, P2 naught is vapor pressure of 2 in pure state.
You understand? Now, if it is this,
I can write this as 1 minus X2 into P1 naught plus X2 P2 naught.
Do we get that? Mm. Why?
Because X1 plus X2?
1.
Since X1 plus X2 has to be 1. They are mole fractions. The sum of the mole fractions of all the components has to be 1, and we are dealing with a binary solution, so there are only 2. Okay. Now what happens? Why did I convert? Because I'd like to plot this, plot the curve of P total starting from X2 is equal to 0 and going to X2 is equal to 1. Correct. I'll try to plot P total versus X2. You understand? That is P total versus X2. So I'd like to draw this graph here. I erase this. I also erase this. Now let us try to understand. What happens is I have my P total out here. I have my P total out here. And I plot my X2 on this. So what I'm trying to do here, I have my X2 is equal to 0. And here my X2 is equal to 1. So this is 1. This is origin. Okay. Now what happens is when X2 is equal to 0, when the second component is absolutely gone, it's not there, then who's contributing the pressure?
X1.
To the pressure? Obviously X1. And how much can it contribute? P1 naught. It'll contribute only P1 naught. So at X2 is equal to 0, we have P1 naught as our total pressure. Is it not? you can see one thing. This is P1 naught plus P2 naught minus P1 naught into X2. That is P total. Try to understand one thing. As I have a linear correlation between X2 and P total, this has to be a straight line. Is it not? This has to be a straight line. Fine? So what happens? So what happens? This is a straight line, okay? Or at least I assume so in the beginning. Now what happens? When x2 goes to 1, when x2 goes to 1, it means what? It is only the second component and first component is gone. So what will be the total contribution? P2 naught. So at x2 is equal to 1, say I have got my pressure as P2 naught. Correct?
Or when x1 is equal to
0. X2 is equal to 1, where x1 is equal to 0, obviously. Correct? So what happens? What will be my plot? My plot will look like that. Okay? My plot will look like that. Let's say this is P2 naught. Fine. This is my plot. How will my plot for P2 look like? P2, here it is 0. Here, when x2 is equal to 0, x2 is equal to 0, what is the contribution of P2? Obviously 0. This. Partial pressure. How much of partial pressure is coming from the component 2? 0. And when it is full, it is so much. P2 naught. So how do I plot this curve? Let us name this as 1, this as 2, and this as 3. So the plot that I have drawn just now, that is plot number 3, correct? That is the plot due to equation number 3. I am trying to plot the second one. So it will be like what? It will go from 0 to P2 naught. So it will be a straight line like that. Is it not? This is the second one. How about the first one? First one here, let me write. If x2 is equal to 0 here, it is x1 is equal to 1, and here x1 is equal to 0. So if x1 is equal to 1, then here the contribution is P1 naught, and here it has dropped to 0. Now you understand what happens? This green curve, this is number 1. The green curve is actually the sum of the curves or of the straight lines 1 and 2. You get it? That means if I had drawn 1 and 2 and at each point I would have added it, then I would have got this curve. The third one. Do you understand that? Now that curve will... The green curve, the curve 3 will go up or it will fall down, will depend on whether it will go up if P1, yes, if P1 naught is smaller, then it will rise, and if P1 naught is greater, then it will fall. Why is that happening? Look here. Since the partial pressure of the component 2 is greater, as your component 2 is increasing, it is bringing in more and more of pressure. Correct? So that's why it has to go up. Physically, you should understand like that. For the same mole fraction, if it has higher pressure, it means what? It means that if you put in this component as its contribution to the whole thing is increasing, it is actually leading to an increase in the vapor pressure. Correct. So I should say